All right, well, welcome everybody. This is the third edition of Aztec On Air, and we are very pleased to have with us Lidia Brito, who is the director of UNESCO Regional Bureau for Science in Latin America and the Caribbean. I've been knowing Lidia for quite a while, so I'm very happy to meet you to this on-air event, Lidia, and hope we will have a good conversation here. Lidia, for those who don't know you, you have a very big scientific background, and you are from Mozambique. You studied in Mozambique and you and in other places. Can you tell us a little bit about your field of expertise in science?
Sure, and I have to say, first of all, hi everybody. It's really a pleasure to be here, and thanks, Walter, for this opportunity. To chat a little bit about an important issue and the role of science centers in museums. Yes, indeed, I have a different kind of career. Let's say I'm a forester by training, and I did study. I was the first class of foresters trained in the country. And then in that area, I specialized in technology and wood science, wood industries, paper, sawmilling. But as my life progressed and my professional life progressed, then I became more and more interested in science policy and the importance of public policies in development. And therefore, I somehow also drift towards more the role of higher education in development and also the public policies as a strong incentive for countries to grow scientifically. And so I do a little bit of everything if you want, but I would say that at the moment the things that are really interesting me is the importance of science and the role of science and technology and innovation in sustainable development, and how can we organize science in a way that the best of science can indeed influence
And we will talk a lot about that during this 25 minutes that ahead of us. We usually complain all the time that people who decide about science and science policy are not scientists themselves. And so here we have someone who is a scientist and has been in these policy positions for a while. But I have a question. Do you use your training as a scientist or your expertise as a scientist in your policy positions as well? How does that match? Is there any kind of things that you have learned by becoming a scientist that help you in your position as a decision maker?
No question about it. I think, and you are right, it's one of the debates, and it's one of the things that we are working on, how to guarantee that scientists and decision makers can talk to each other and society. We say that in the S in UNESCO is science, but it's also society. And that implies a very close dialogue between scientists and policymakers and society to define what are the best ways to promote knowledge for development. Mm-hmm. And it does help when you have a scientific background because you have your peers. It's much easier, I think, for me to engage with my fellow colleagues in science as it is also to make the bridge between science and policy making. So I would say that in that case, I'm quite fortunate. And I keep my interests alive. So I'm a member of several networks in forestry and in science and in public policy. So I try to keep at least part of me engaged in the scientific process and scientific networks, recognizing that, of course, I'm more now on the policy making side.
So you have been Minister of Science and Research in Mozambique, and then after that you went to UNESCO. That's where your first time you had this kind of position. It was already about sustainability and sustainability issues. Is there anything that you have been doing there in Paris that you remember as being one of the significant contributions that you could make from that position in the sustainability area?
Well, I cannot say it was my doing. But I would say that the science sector in UNESCO is a very strong sector with a lot of strong networks in both in the scientific world but also with governments and therefore with the policy-making community. I think what we have been strengthening more and more is precisely this interface between science and decision making and policy making, and bringing also issues related to society and how to empower society through science to really pursue a more sustainable development. Mm-hmm. As you know, also UNESCO is also the secretariat for the advisory scientific committee that was set by the UN Secretary General. So that also positions our organization in a very good position to really bring the best of science to the global policy dialogue. So definitely in the last 5-6 years, UNESCO has strengthened that. And I would say that also the international years that we organized, the fact that we created the Global Observatory on Science and Technology and Innovation Policies, are tools that can be used by member states, by the scientific community, to really monitor where are we going and what are the gaps in this interaction and in this
interaction. That may be the case when you speak between the relation of UNESCO and the scientific communities and your peers, as you said earlier, but the vision of the public about that is maybe not the same. How do you explain the difference between how the public perceives the role of UNESCO and how the scientific community perceives it?
Well, it's difficult to measure. Of course, UNESCO is well known by education, by the cultural work, and the World Heritage Sites of UNESCO are well known. But society also knows about UNESCO science. We don't do science in itself. What we guarantee is that member states have policies and human capacity to pursue science policy, endeavor. We bring the communities together, both at regional and at global level. We create networks. You have a lot of UNESCO chairs all around the world. They talk to each other. We have the Category 2 centers of UNESCO. The majority of them are in science topics. We have also the national committees for our water program, for our man and biosphere program, for our social science program and social transformation, the MOST program. So it's not that we are not known or that the public don't know us. And in terms of scientific community, I think we are very much there. We have several networks where we engage with scientists. And several of the people in UNESCO have been quite successful scientists themselves. And I think that's an interesting characteristic of the science sector in UNESCO, is that most of us went through a scientific career before we came to the organization. And that, of course, gives us a good place.
No, I understand. You have been very instrumental in the success of the Planet Under Pressure Conference in 2012. And for those who don't know, yeah, you were certainly. And for those who don't know, or to refresh memory for the others, is that this was the meeting of the scientific community in preparation of the Rio Summit, and a number of very important decisions have been made. We were very, very happy to be there as well, and we can come back to that in a minute. But what would you say, have these 4,000 scientists from all over the world who were there together for 3 days, how have they been able to influence the Rio Summit?
Well, I would say that the Planet Under Pressure influencing the Rio Summit, in effect, started much before the summit, because you can't expect in such a global meeting to come up 3 months before with a declaration, and that declaration to be the center of discussion during the summit, because to organize a summit like this one, you start preparing it much, much before. And that's what we did with Planet Under Pressure. We start preparing it much, much before, in effect 2 years before. And in that process, what we were producing was different in certain important subjects that were important for a reflection on a planet that is under pressure. And these policy briefings, they really permeate several processes that were taking place at the same time. One was the production of the report of the Global Sustainability Panel, that was Resilient People, Resilient Planet. That That was a very important report, and that influenced quite a lot the agenda in Rio. Mm-hmm. If you recall, the Sustainable Development Goals, the need to have a science advice mechanism at global level, and therefore the creation by the UN Secretary of the Scientific Advisory Board, mm-hmm. And entrust UNESCO with the Secretariat, and our Director General is the chair of that. The fact that we also discussed the importance of a different kind of science, a science much more connected to development issues, much more integrated, much more transdisciplinary. Also the different actors, how to bring, you know, from the scientific community, but the policymakers, private and public spheres, and also society and associations like one of like yours, how to bring, for instance, science communicators and science museums and centers into the debate. So, you know, I'm always very positive. For me, we initiated a trend. We are not there yet. When you look to the Sustainable Development Goals, you're still missing some targets that are science related. Probably we were not able to influence a lot the discussion of the Sustainable Development Goals themselves. Mm-hmm. But I believe that these are processes. The fact that we have now scientific advisory, the fact that Sustainable Development Goals are in place and they are universal. If you remember, these were the things that Planet Under Pressure put on the table. Mm-hmm. If it's the Anthropocene, it's about all of us and humanity as a whole. And therefore, we have to have universal goals. We have to have commitments. We have to have this interface. So I would say that in that respect, Planet Under Pressure was quite successful. And it was, the conference was, let's say, the wrap-up of all these ideas that during 2 years, a lot of very good researchers were working on.
And I took away from them that something that is really going to stay with me for a long time. And that is something that actually the scientific community has evolved over the last years. And they want to see the result of their work really translated into action and into decisions. And I had no clue before that how big this movement was, certainly in the field of the scientists that have to do with sustainability. And for me, so all this trend where the scientific community is trying to organize itself and find the bridges and the avenues to bring that to the decision makers and work with them to have evidence-based decision on this thing. This is, for me, such an eye-opener.
Yeah. And you have the Future Earth program, a 10-year initiative between several partners, including ITSU, UNESCO, and others. And it's precisely about that, this perspective of the co-design of scientific programs and the co-production of knowledge. That opens avenues that were not there before. Mm-hmm. And really, like you, I think we all did talk about these things, but it was indeed in the conference that it was clear that the scientific community is ready. It's ready and is doing it.
It's doing
moving
it.
Ahead. Yeah, and absolutely. It was very gratifying.
And so we were very happy that we were invited to be the outreach partner, and I think this was the first time this ever happened in history, where Science Center, that we had 250 of them organizing events on sustainability at the occasion of that meeting, and there were direct connections between scientists in London and in other places of the world. From that point of view, I think it has never been matched even since. A little frustration, however, that I have to share with you, and you know that, I'm sure that you know that, is that still I don't think that the scientific community takes us seriously enough. They focus on decision makers to have evidence-based decisions in sustainability. They don't trust enough the public in being supportive of that. And we as science centers educate the public in all these difficult issues with sustainability. If the dialogue between the scientific and the community and the politicians is going to be successful, my opinion is that it's only going to be if it is supported from the outside, from a well-educated public. And so
no,
what I want is a good partnership with the scientific community to make that possible.
You know, Walter, we have discussed this so many times, and I agree absolutely with you. And that's why I always say that the science or the S in UNESCO is science, but it's also society. And therefore, it's very important that science communicators, museums, centers of science really be part of this transformation. That is really a transformation that goes much deeper than how much knowledge do you have about what is happening in the world. It's about behavior change, it's about new models of development, it is about interdependence and interconnectivity. It scales, let's say. So clearly, I agree absolutely with you that science centers and science museums still have a huge role to play, and that's why we are meeting next week in Netherlands in the Congress on that, and really trying to say, okay, what are other roles that science centers and science museums can play? And I would say that it's again a dialogue, the way I see it, and more than open to work with you guys to try to pilot some experiences. For example, it would be very nice if big science centers and museums would create specific lectures of non-scientists in this area of sustainability where the public could see these faces and the scientists also could see the faces of society when they explain their work, the doubts they have, the issues they can solve. Having the museums and the centers to be privileged spaces for dialogue between science, policymakers, and society. And we can think together, maybe for the LAC region, we will be with Red Pop in Medellin, trying to convince and trying to organize maybe a pilot experiment where we will do a series of lectures in the different science museums and centers in the region, where we would bring scientists that would speak about these things. Of course, it also has to do of the importance of science communication. And as you know, this is something that we have been discussing in academia for a long time, because for a long time, science communication was among your peers. Mm-hmm. We are finally changing that. We are saying science communication is much broader than that. And there are actors that have to be part of the discussion of the co-production of knowledge, and even before in the co-design. So the fact, for instance, that FutureEarth has an engagement committee plus the scientific committee, they have an engagement committee, is precisely to try to bring the voices of other actors that are many times outside the scientific debate, in particular during the design of the programs and in the production of knowledge. And so I think there are some things going on.
I agree with you that it should be a dialogue and not, you know, continuation of this, what we still call the deficit model, where it is people need to know more science and more educated in science, and you have to give them more and more science so that they understand and support what the scientists say. It's also for the scientists to understand what the expectations from the public are about sustainability. What are their priorities? What would they like to see researched? And if the scientists go in certain directions, what can we as the public do with the results of that at all? And so it's a dialogue between the two and not just a one-way thing.
Yeah, I agree. And that's why I'm saying that the science museums and the science centers can become an incredible good space for that kind of dialogue. And in effect, even across generations, because you will have the younger people, you will have the older people, you basically have everybody from society going there.
Yeah,
so let's think about it in Medellin. Let's think, how can we do maybe a pilot and see how can we create these spaces? Because the scientists are ready, like you said.
Yeah, absolutely.
They are ready, they are conscious. So they have to do more.
And so to come, we come back to that in a second. But before that, and we jumped over this topic that I wanted to address with you, because you have, you know, you are in Latin America and in the Caribbean, so you have a specific mission there, I guess. So what is that? What is so specific about Latin America and the Caribbean about the need for science and technology? What are your priorities there? What do you want to achieve?
Yeah, that's a very good question. As you know, I'm basically now a year here. So learning and still understanding the region is a very diverse region with different realities, big countries, smaller countries. But in general, it's a region that invested a lot in their scientific capacity. So that's a very good, strong point of Latin America and the Caribbean. They have a good scientific community. Sometimes small, because the countries are small, the population is not that large, but they have a good basis in science. And that's a plus, and for something we are looking forward to work with them more and more. The other characteristic is also that it's quite balanced in gender. They are at the moment the region with more female researchers in the world.
Oh, really?
So they are above the average. They are about 45%, of course, with different.
Any particular reason for that?
I think it's history. I think it's the fact that they also have good universities and women just had access to go. And I think also public policies, where you see governments creating conditions for everybody to have access to higher education. In many countries, higher education is not paid. And so it does open, doesn't have tuition and fees, so it does open opportunities for all to access higher education. And of course, then you see also very strong women here, both in the political side and they are also in the scientific side. Where we have a challenge, because this is a continent that has a huge potential to grow and needs to create a lot of partnerships and internationalize, in a way, the science they do. And the governments have put it collaboration, international collaboration, South-South collaboration in the arena of science and technology as a huge part of their investments in the years to come. And to incentivize innovation. A lot of the studies of CEPAL and BID, etc., shows that the companies, the business components are too small and not as innovative as you would expect in a region that has quite a lot of scientific capacity. So how to bring this innovation from the science they have here to the production cycle. They are also very vulnerable to climate change. So clearly climate change is a huge issue in this region, and therefore a lot of initiatives are taking place how to link the science to the decision-making processes to adapt, to mitigate whatever is coming with these changes that we are seeing. So in our, let me say that our role here in UNESCO is to really support these efforts and these visions so that the governments in the region have the capacity to meet and to share ideas, bringing best practices, connecting them with other good experience around the world, opening up the networks to more global discussions and more global networks, and really on the public policy side. So we believe that there is a lot to be done still, principally because, as we were talking before, the production of knowledge is changing. So how do you support the countries and the universities and the research centers also to transform themselves, so that they can produce the science that is needed now.
Here is a thought, Lydia, and maybe that is one of the things we can discuss next week in Medellin. Sure. So you speak about innovation, and one of the things that we are testing worldwide now with the science centers is to find out where can kids be educated to become innovators. And what we find, and we have not proven it yet, and don't misunderstand me well, we don't think the schools are well equipped today to do that, that the schools do with the particular way that they teach things, not only science, but all. are not necessarily the places where you create innovators or educate innovators. But science centers, however, have a very different approach to education, with hands-on, with groups work, with interdisciplinary approaches, with using new technologies to do that. And so if there is a place where you can test how you create innovators, science centers look be better places than schools today.
I would even go further than that. And in fact, just to give you an idea how important this subject is in the region, in the last 6 months, we had already two regional meetings discussing science education and the quality of science education. And every time we meet the minister of education or of science, science education comes as an important area, priority area for the countries. So regional wide, they know that they have to improve their science education. I think it's a two-way, again, a dialogue. Mm-hmm. Because the kids do spend quite a lot of time, spend a lot of time in the schoolroom and with teachers. So they have to also have good science education in the schools.
Of course.
They can be complemented and should be complemented with other activities. And for the schools to improve their science education, definitely they will need support from science centers and science museums. As they will need support from academia, from, you know, again, it's not just the schools transforming or the teachers, it's how can we come together and say, okay, we can do this, and let's do it. So definitely, the role of science museums and science centers in scientific education is a very important one. There is a new project here in Uruguay that is called the Museum of the Time, Museo del Tiempo.
Yeah.
And what is interesting is they are planning.
Curated by my old friend Wagensberg.
Yeah, but you know, they are doing it. But what is interesting, just to give you an idea, how things are already moving in the direction you are talking about. They are creating in the museum a center for science education. Mm-hmm. The museum itself will have a center that will deal with science education programs in the museum, but further than that, will research how to do better science education. Mm-hmm. So these are the kinds of things I'm talking about. Brazil is, for instance, and we will open this year in Rio de Janeiro, and I'm sure you are aware of that, of the Museum of Tomorrow.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Once again, they have this observatory where research will be conducted on sustainability. Absolutely. But they will also have this laboratory where the visitors to the museum will have the chance to do science and to apply some of the results of science. And so hands-on. So what I'm seeing here in this region, and I'm very happy to be here, I have to say, because it's exciting to be here, is that they are this very important programs that are already forward looking and really taking all these learning experiences to say we can do it differently with much stronger impact. And I think that's great. And again, we should talk about this in Medellin.
And I was going to say, so first let me take the opportunity here to salute our friends in Latin America who are watching this and who are hopefully will meet next week in Medellin, where we can continue that conversation. So if you want to wrap up now, so what do you expect from REDPOP in the near future?
As you know, REDPOP was a network that was created by this office much before I came here, been a very important partner to UNESCO. We are part of their council. We organize conference together, we organize competitions together, we produce guidelines, you know, reflection papers, we do research with them in a lot of aspects. So definitely what we expect from REDPOP is to continue to be this important partner for UNESCO. And I'm really looking forward to this Congress, because the title is wonderful, because it's art, technology and science, new ways of learning, of knowing, if you want. I don't know how to translate from Spanish. But precisely, again, a very different view of science communication, bringing other aspects of communication that is arts, and also the idea that you maybe have to change the way you learn. So very open in that also, very futuristic on that. So what we expect with them is definitely to do more. We have a lot of big projects here. We have now a competition for the 70th anniversary of UNESCO. So we want to produce or to select the best posters that will show the impact of UNESCO science in Latin America in the last 70 years. So we are launching this week this competition. We hope all our partners will help us to disseminate the competition so that we can have the best there. We have a lot of programs on science education with science teachers, with students. We start now the science slams, and we will have in Montevideo in August the one for Uruguay, where we use also monologues and artistic ways of communicating science, involving young people, but also giving the capacity of young people to communicate science in different way. We are looking also, and here we work a lot with science journalists that are another partners that are key to all the things we are talking about. It's how to disseminate the best success stories of science, technology, and innovation for development in the national and regional level. So you see, so in a way, our office is trying to bring all these actors together and support what the countries are already doing.
Well, obviously, Lydia, we have a lot to talk about. We could go on for a long time, and hopefully, yes, the good thing is that we will meet next week in Medellin, and
definitely,
and all our friends from RedPop, we will have the chance to continue that conversation. Thank you so much for having been with us to accept our invitation, and I'm really looking forward to meet you next week. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Ciao.